Welcome to Chapel at Hardin-Simmons University. Here at HSU, we value the importance of gathering together as a community of faculty, staff, and students to worship God and encourage one another in our Christian walk.
This weekly time together is an opportunity for us to grow as a community of worshipers as we study the Word of God, engage with dynamic speakers, and learn to do life together. No matter who we are or where we've come from, this is our time to learn,
grow,
serve,
love,
and worship.
Welcome to Chapel. We're so glad you're here.
All right. Hello, everybody. Good morning. How are y'all doing this morning? Yeah, I like that energy. All right. Well, this is day 3 of Cornerstone. I hope y'all have enjoyed the last 2 days, but I'm excited to hear what the word is today. So I'm going to invite y'all to stand and worship with us this morning.
Child of God, yes, sir.
together once again. that, God, that we can just surrender everything, all of the anxiety and the, God, just the earthly things that we often hold on to in this world. I just pray that we can lay that all down at your feet this morning and every day when we wake up, God. It's a constant thing. I pray that, God, that we can just surrender and say, here I am. And Lord, you're so good, and you can do so many great things in us, Jesus, if we would just let you. So I pray that, God, that we could just take a posture of surrender this morning and just, God, surrender ourselves to you and all that we do that can be for your glory. God, I thank you for this morning and for this time of worship that we get with one another, God, and I thank you for your goodness and for your mercy and that you are constant, Jesus. I thank you for that. God, I pray over the word that we're going to hear this morning. I pray that you would just speak to us, Jesus, that we can open our eyes and our hearts and our ears just to hear what you have for us this morning. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Third time's a charm. Can we make the devil real mad and just give a roar shouting out to the Lord because he is good? We're almost there. Can we do it one more time? Y'all know my mom is up the street. I want her to hear us today shouting out that the Lord is good. Can we give God a roar? Amen. Again, it is a blessing to be here. All good things come to an end. And so I hate to leave today, but there is a word from the Lord today. I have enjoyed the time here and talking with students. Tanner, I appreciate you. Dr. B, appreciate you. And Dr. Travis, we thank God for him. If you have your device, if you return to Mark chapter 2, I believe the Lord has a word for us as we conclude Cornerstone for 2021. Mark chapter 2. Go ahead and click there. Let me know when you're there by saying word up. Okay, that's about three. Is anyone else clicking? Y'all can't look at me and be clicking at the same time. Y'all got to look at the Bible. Look at the Bible. Word up? All right, Mark chapter 2. We'll look at verses 1 through 12. Reads like this. And again he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door. And he preached the word to them. They came to him bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they had reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, "Why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Arise, take up your bed and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house." Everybody say, "Go to your house." Immediately he arose, took up the bed, went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." My daughter, I told y'all the other day that she is at Baylor. I dropped her off. She's my oldest daughter, so I'm already having, she's my oldest child, but I'm already having separation anxiety. So we dropped her off at Baylor and we moved everything in. I've already learned that there are easier ways to move into dorms and apartments at the university. We get to her apartment and we have to walk up two flights to get to her room. It's a Monday and we move everything in. So we move everything in. We come back on Thursday of the same week only to discover that we are in the wrong room. And so we go to the front desk and they say, listen, you're not on the second floor. Micaiah really is on the third floor. And so we have to move all of her stuff to the third floor. And as we get to the third floor, we're trying to get into her new room and we can't get in the room. We tried the key card to get in the room and we can't get in the room. And I'm already aggravated. I'm evangelically ticked off because we're already moved. Perhaps she should have came to Hardin-Simmons, maybe. So I'm already upset and we can't get in the door. So we go back down to the desk and we tell the lady, listen, we can't get in the door. And she had the nerve to look at me and say, do y'all know how to use the key card? We've had better rooms than this, ma'am. It's this dorm, this apartment ain't all that. I know that's bad grammar, but it ain't all that. I'm already upset, don't have time to play games with you. She said, okay, Mr. Jones, let me see the card that you have. And so I gave her the key card that I had. She said, oh, Mr. Jones, here's your problem. You're trying to use the key card that we gave you Monday on the second floor, now on the third floor. And she was really preaching to me because she allowed me to see that you can't use yesterday's keys for today's doors. You can't use yesterday's tools for today's task. And you can't use yesterday's weapons for today's wars. God oftentimes uses doors to get us to a new level in Him. And as we continue to talk about interruptions, today I want to talk about a disruption and how God uses disruptions, doors, and detours to get us into the destiny that He has for us. I'll say it again. I want to talk about how God can use doors, detours. He can also use keys and closed doors to get us into the destiny that He wants us to be in. And so in this text, you don't see the doors, but there's four doors I want us to walk through today. I believe that will help us understand divine interruptions and divine disruptions. Would you like to know what doors are in the text this morning? All right, I think I got three of you with me this morning. There's a few doors that we're going to walk through that I think will help us. The first door that we see in Mark chapter 2 is a door of disappointment. A door of disappointment. The text says in verse 1, Mark chapter 2, and again he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even at the door. And he preached to them, and they came to him bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. We have to understand that in life we will deal with doors of disappointment. There's a paralytic. He can't walk, obviously. If he can't walk and he's paralyzed, he probably doesn't have a job. If he doesn't have a job, he can't take care of his family if he has a family. As a matter of fact, if he's a paralytic here in the text, he would be considered an outcast. He would be a part of the least, the left out, and the looked over. He's a paralytic, and Jesus is preaching in the house, but he can't get in the house because, number one, he can't walk. And number two, there's a crowd blocking the door. But the text says that there's four men who come and pick him up. I need us to understand today that even though there are doors of disappointment in life, maybe you're disappointed this morning. There's some things that you're dealing with in your life you wouldn't dare tell anyone, but you are dealing with some stuff now, some doors of disappointment, some things that you thought were going to happen, some things that you thought would go through. But in life, we all must deal with doors of disappointment. But even though there's this door of disappointment, there's also a door of determination. The four friends come and pick the paralytic up, and they try to get him through the door, but they can't get through the door because of the crowd. And so because there's a crowd at the door, they have to have this door of determination because they have to find a different way, a new way. They have to take a detour in order to get their friend to Jesus. Pause. They're trying to get their friend to Jesus. Pause. What friends are you trying to get to Jesus? Do you just come to school and kind of do your thing? Or have you been saved so that you could share Jesus with someone else? These guys, I like them because even though they deal with a door of disappointment, they have a door of determination, and they don't stop when one door is closed, because I've been told, if you read the news, if you read the newspaper, I've been told that your generation, millennials, Gen Z, are a generation of quitters. If you don't like what's going on, you'll quit. If you don't like where you're at, you'll quit. If you don't like the team, you'll quit and go across town to another team. But I believe there's a group of millennials who are not quitters, who may enter or see doors of disappointment, but they also see doors of determination and opportunity where God can use you to go through another door. I like these fellas because even though they couldn't get through the door, they found another way. I don't know how they did it. Maybe they started talking to each other. Hey, man, we've got to get him to Jesus. How y'all think we should do it? Maybe one of them said, I didn't see any video cameras around the side of the house, so maybe we can pick him up and go to the side of the house and go up and break through. Now, they're not telling the paralytic. I don't think they're telling him what they're going to do. He would be afraid if they started talking like that. So they're probably whispering. What should we do with him? How can we get him there? But they have this door of determination, and they go up the side of the house, and they begin to dig down the roof. They begin to dig through the roof so they can lower their friend to Jesus. I said it on Tuesday. If Jesus is preaching, there has to be some dirt and dust that's coming down while Jesus is preaching. They interrupt Jesus, and I know he's preaching good because Tanner, he's preaching the word, and the Bible says he is the word, so he's preaching about himself. So I know he's preaching good, and they disrupt and interrupt Jesus as they lower their friend down, but Jesus is cool. Jesus says, you've been dealing with doors of disappointment, and I see this door of determination. But number three, they have this door of divinity where they bring the paralytic and they get him all the way to Jesus. I like these guys because they understand that it's important for them to get this man to Jesus. I like these guys because if the crowd was at the door, that means people were walking up to the house while Jesus was preaching, and they were stepping over the paralytic man just to get to Jesus. But I'm grateful for these four friends because they stop and they understand that it's not just enough for me to get to Jesus, but I need to get someone else to Jesus. In other words, they understand that it's important to get those who can't get themselves to Jesus to Jesus. They understand that my job, my assignment, is to get lost people to Jesus. As a matter of fact, 2 Corinthians talks about our job as a believer is to be an ambassador and to reconcile the world to Christ. You only got one job. I know that's bad grammar. You only got one job. Your job as a believer is to get someone else to Jesus. You only got one job. That's one of my favorite shows, favorite segments on ESPN. Y'all watch ESPN? One of my favorite segments on ESPN is You Only Got One Job. What they would talk about is they would show a film or a video of a quarterback dropping back, and he would throw the pass to the receiver in the end zone, and all the receiver has to do is catch the ball. No one's around him. No one's bothering him, and he drops the ball, and then they all shout out together, "You only had one job." You only have one job. That's to get someone else to Jesus, because you're an ambassador for Christ. You do know what an ambassador is. An ambassador is a representative that comes from one country to go to another country, but represents his or her own country. And so the Bible calls you an ambassador, because as you sit in this world, as you sit on this campus, your job is to be an ambassador for the kingdom of heaven. You are an ambassador for Christ. And what the ambassador does in a foreign land, they check into the embassy in that land. In the embassy, that's where they find the food that they would eat at home. That's where they find the language they would hear back home. That's where they get their comfort and their joy and their energy and their motivation, in the embassy. And the local church is the embassy for the ambassador. And your job is to carry out and represent where you come from, so that when you die, you'll have a home going, because you weren't designed to stay here anyway. You're from another place if you know Jesus. You're from the kingdom of heaven, and you're an ambassador here to represent him, and you only have one job. And so I like these guys, because they stop by and they get the paralytic, and they understand that they have to get him to Jesus. I think the problem with our nation, our world today, is that we don't understand what life really is. We know the cost of everything, but the value of nothing. I'll say it like this. This is my last day, so I can say this, Tanner. If I get kicked out today, this is my last day. I am a Philadelphia Eagle fan. Beyond a Philadelphia Eagle fan, I am a Mike Vick fan. Now, y'all are kind of young. I don't even know if y'all know who Mike Vick is, but Mike Vick was the man. Mike Vick got into some trouble because he had dogs fighting, right? And so Mike Vick ended up going to prison. But when he got out of prison, my team, the Philadelphia Eagles, gave him a chance, the opportunity to come and be the quarterback for the Philadelphia Eagles. And as he comes to the Philadelphia Eagles, we're excited because we have Mike Vick on our team. We have Mike Vick. He is the man. And what happens is Mike Vick even gets traded from the Philadelphia Eagles. And as he gets traded, I wanted an authentic Mike Vick jersey. And so I went to the mall. Y'all, I'm balling on a budget. I ain't got money like that, right? And so Clarence is my best friend. I'll say it again. Clarence is my best friend. One more time. Clarence, y'all are young, the clearance rack. I go to the clearance rack. And when I go to the clearance rack, I find an authentic Nike Mike Vick jersey. And it says 1999. What? An authentic Nike Mike Vick jersey? $19? Something is wrong. So I grab it quick. I go to the counter to check out. And as I check out, the lady at the counter says, "Well, there's also another discount. It's going to be $12. Listen, typically I'm kind of from the hood, y'all, so you don't ask where the hookup came from. You just kind of take the hookup. You don't ask no questions. You just kind of take the hookup and keep it moving. But I had to ask, why is this jersey marked down? She says, "It's marked down because Mike Vick has been traded, so the jersey has lost its value." And I believe in our nation today, we are dealing with people on the basis of how we value them. But we should see them like Christ sees them and value them like Christ values them. I like these fellas because they stop by and get the paralytic, and they get him to the door of divinity. As they lower him down to Jesus, can't y'all see him come through the roof And they lower him to Jesus. And as they get him to Jesus, Jesus says that your sins are forgiven. And as Jesus says your sins are forgiven, I believe Jesus thinks about what he did for us. I bet Jesus says something like, y'all are my dudes. Y'all are my type of guys. I like y'all because y'all did what I did over 2,000 years ago. I came from heaven down through dirt and dust and mess so that I could get to you, so that I could forgive you for your sins. Y'all are my guys. Y'all are my type of guys. I like what y'all are doing. They get him to Jesus through the door of divinity. So they deal with this door of disappointment. They deal with this door of determination. They deal with this door of divinity, only to get him to a door of destiny. And so as he's forgiven of his sins, I can hear his friends saying, listen, we brought him to you, Jesus, not for his sins to be forgiven. We wanted him to walk again. So the text says that the crowd begins to murmur in their hearts. They're asking, why is Jesus forgiving sins? Why is he even doing this? And as a matter of fact, the man makes it to his destiny because of a crowd who didn't want him there. I'll say it again. The man makes it to his destiny because he has to deal with a crowd that doesn't want him there. Perhaps there's somebody here today where maybe you're a first-generation college student, and maybe there's been some haters, some people who don't want you to make it. Maybe there's just some haters in your life. God hears what they're thinking in their minds, and he says, so I'm not going to only forgive his sins, I'm going to give him fresh legs. And so the text says that the man gets up, grabs his mat, and goes home. What's intriguing about this text is the door was blocked by the crowd so that they couldn't get the paralytic to Jesus. But at the end of this text, the crowd moves to the side so that he can walk out of the house. Don't be the crowd that prevents others from getting to Jesus. As a matter of fact, does the crowd you hang with bring you closer to Christ or further from Christ? These are some good friends, and you need to understand that you need to surround yourself by friends and people who don't take you away from Christ, but actually take you to Christ. He goes home another way. I told y'all I lived two blocks from here, from Hardin-Simmons. And I remember when my grandfather died, we lived on 1781 Sandifer Street. Y'all go by there and just thank God for that house if y'all ever in the neighborhood. Two blocks from here, 1781 Sandifer Street. That's where my grandfather lived. And my grandfather died in that house. I remember the day like it was yesterday. And so as my grandfather died, he was in the room literally dying. My aunt told me and my cousins to come in and say our final goodbyes to my grandfather. And I was close to my grandfather. I loved my grandfather. My grandfather would give me money, give me time. He just loved me. And so my heart was broken. I remember when my grandfather died that day, I ran from 1781 Sandifer Street, and I cut through Hardin-Simmons. As I cut through Hardin-Simmons, leaving Sandifer Street, I sat on the steps of the chapel crying. Here's the reality, though. I knew how to get to the chapel at Hardin-Simmons because me and my sisters and my cousins would use Hardin-Simmons as the shortcut to get to Taco Bell. Taco Bell was our destination, but Hardin-Simmons was our shortcut. You're taking this shortcut through Hardin-Simmons. Don't miss the opportunity to see God, to see the amazing things God can do in your life. by cutting through. God wants to do amazing things in your life. And I must say this, if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, the door of divinity is still open. As a matter of fact, Jesus says, I am the door. And so what I want to do today as we conclude Cornerstone is I want us to bow our heads, close our eyes. No one's looking around. Everyone's bowed. Eyes are closed. No one's watching. No one sees except me and God. I want you to raise your hand if you're dealing with a door of disappointment. You're just dealing with some disappointments in life. Raise your hand. I see you. I see all of you. I see you. I see you. You can put your hands down. Raise your hand if this shortcut through Hardin-Simmons has just been difficult. It's just been a tough time. I see all of you. I see your hands. I see your hands. You can put your hands down. Raise your hand if you've never entered into the door of divinity where you've made Jesus the Lord of your life. You've never made him the Lord of your life. You've never. I see your hand. Raise your hand. I see your hands. I see your hands. Those of you that have your hands up now, heads are still bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you really want Jesus to come into your heart, to come into your life, we're going to do that right now. I just want you to repeat after me. It's a really short prayer. I want you to say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Lord, I know you came to save me. I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. And today I want you to come into my heart. I know I'm not going to do everything right. I know I'm not going to dot every I and cross every T. But Lord, here's my life, and I give it to you. If you pray that prayer with me and you made a decision to make Jesus the Lord of your life, I want you to get with Dr. B or Dr. Travis or Tanner. I want you to tell them that you made Jesus the Lord of your life. And I want to hear about what God is about to do in your life. Those that raised your hand about dealing with disappointment and just dealing with difficult times here, I'm going to pray for you and we'll conclude. Father, we thank you today. Several hands that went up saying they don't know you as their personal Savior. I pray today that not just a prayer was prayed, but Lord, their hearts were given to you, that they opened their hearts to receive you. I pray for that today. Those students that are dealing with disappointment, Lord, I pray that you would give them a supernatural breath of fresh air, that you would give them relief, Lord, that you would give them aid, that you would let them know that your presence is still in their life, and Lord, they can have a spirit and go through the door of determination, even though they're dealing with difficult times, and even though they're dealing with doors of disappointment, that you have a door of destiny for them, and Lord, I pray that they would walk in it in Jesus' name. A special prayer over this entire campus. Lord, that you would have your way at Hardin-Simmons University. Lord, that Abilene would see that there's an overflow from the students, a wave from the students, some students that just love Jesus. And Lord, I pray that Abilene would be saturated, cities around Abilene, just by these students who have just taken a shortcut through Hardin-Simmons. We love you, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.